I'm going to call this meeting to order. June 8th meeting of the Selectmen. And the first item on our agenda is a public hearing for the Home Annual Action Plan.
Move that the Selectmen open the public hearing.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, 500. And we have both Liz Rust and Assistant Town Manager Porter. So why don't you...
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. I'm Liz Rust. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Nice to see you. So this is a public hearing to propose a substantial amendment to the Home Annual Action Plan. We've done this before when we were doing the last project for the Housing Authority. And this is, again, so as we're proposing this particular project, we come before you to formally move the money from undesignated into the project from the home perspective. So that's the procedural part of what's happening today. We're proposing to vote that we move this $32,264 from undesignated 2 years worth of funds to establish a tenant-based rental assistance program for Bedford that would be comprised of providing security deposit and first month rent for eligible applicants into eligible apartment units. So as we know, that it's very difficult to spend the home funds, and even this $32,000 is comprised of 2 years of home funds. So 1 year was maybe 19, and now the annual allocation is more around $12,000-$13,000. We've spent some time thinking about what kinds of programs might work for this, for the home program. And Waltham has just recently rolled out a similar program to this, so that we spent some time looking at theirs and have...
Hope you're right, and I hope that there's not a kind of a flood of people that come out and qualify for this eligible list. And another issue arises that, you know, I guess that was my concern, is if you get more than you anticipate, you know, how to answer to that need with only this amount of funds and the timing that we have.
I feel very confident that we won't have 10 people.
Right. Well, you know better than I do, so that's good.
So, the income limits are low and the rent limits are lower.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. No, that was my only thought on it.
So is the greater challenge the apartment than the individual?
I think both together. It's the combination.
Combination.
Yeah. So we'll see. As I said, we wanted to get a new rent standard authorized by HUD. So I'm not really sure exactly what that process is, but I'm sure we will be working on it. And that would might really open it up some.
Okay.
And we did talk about whether it would be, it's hard to make it a lottery kind of situation or something like that, because when you have your apartment, I mean, you're ready to go right then, so you can't really hold it while you're waiting to see if there are other applicants. It really lends itself, especially with these 17 steps, to a first come, first serve. The person comes and you just work the process till it goes or doesn't go.
Right.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Any comments from the public?
Move that the hearing be closed.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to close the hearing. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. And so, presumably you need a vote of support.
Move that Selectmen approve the tenant-based rental assistance program using home project funds administered by the Regional Housing Services Office.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comments, discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, 500. Thank you very much.
Go forth and do good.
Well, don't go forth yet.
Right, because you're still here.
The next item on our agenda. An update from the Regional Housing Services Office.
Right, so you have a little update here, and then the other part of this update is signing the intermunicipal agreement, which you probably have there too. And so this is just to give you some background on what's been going on for this year, what our thoughts are for next year, while you sign, right? okay, so here we have the service model there. I always like to show that. It shows all the towns. So Burlington's been added in this year, and we've moved to Concord. This is our website that we just launched, which I'll do a little demo for you. So this is new in the last month. In terms of the inventory summary, we now have over 5,000 units on the subsidized housing inventory across all the 7 towns. So that's really grown. Every town has a pipeline, and so we're always adding new units. Almost 20% of them are local action program, where the town is the monitoring agent, so we're doing all of that monitoring work. So we continue to standardize the program. And you can see there's a lot of numbers there of how Bedford and the other towns look in terms of how many units there are and how many rental and the different kinds of rental units and what have you. The next slide talks about the FY15 program review. And so this just has a work plan look. And I'll just start on the upper right and walk through that just briefly. We do the ownership monitoring, so this is where we send letters to all the owners. We've gotten a 90% response rate from Bedford. I never quite understand why we don't get 100% filling. I mean, it takes about 2 minutes for someone to do. We do the self-addressed envelopes, and we do 3 mailings. And it's a good thing. We're able to remind people of their deed riders and what their restrictions are, though even as late as 2 weeks ago, we had someone who refinanced without approval. And they knew that they needed approval. And they had refinanced in the past without approval, and we had sent them a compliance violation letter, and they did it again 2 weeks ago.
Is there a recording of the need for approval so that banks would see that approval is needed?
Well, yes. The deed restriction.
So the banks can see that the restriction exists.
Yes, and the restriction
and they ignore
says.
It. And they ignore it.
And the restriction says that approval is needed. And the owner knew it.
No, but the bank ignores it too.
Yeah.
Right, if they don't read.
Yeah. They don't read the whole deed restriction. And,
kind of love banks.
So after the fact, the bank is now trying to obtain approval, and this particular owner is over-financed, so they have too much, you know, over the value of their home, and DHCD will not approve it unless they, so we're going through all that.
Mm-hmm.
We also are involved with the LIP rental monitoring, so there are 3 LIP rental projects here, Taylor Pond, Patriot Place, and the Village at Concord Road. And so our visits are coming up in August, and we'll do the report in September, and often we come and present that report to you. So, and that's always important to keep in touch there. Some things that have gone on is Taylor Pond had a new leasing agent who started requiring a deposit to be on the waiting list for the affordable units. And we were apprised of that and reminded them that no, that they couldn't do that, and they had to return all the money to the people. And, so it's an ongoing process. Things change, new personnel come in, the home program, we've talked about that. The Railroad Avenue, I think that's just really finishing up now. There's just a tiny bit left. And then the rental assistance program. The inventory monitoring. So this is just really keeping track of, and helping with all the different projects and units that you have. Continue to do some analysis on Bedford Village. That has the expiring use in 2018. And we think that maybe the selectmen in the town might want to send a letter to the owners, open up communications there, and start to talk about what their plans are and thoughts about preserving that affordability. So we've talked about that a little bit, and maybe we can work with Rick and Jessica to sort of draft something for you and your signature. But I think that you're interested in preserving the affordability there, and that's probably the best thing to do now. We've had some initial understanding from Mass Housing. It's a little early for them in terms of putting the deal together and how much would it take. And I think that having the town partner with Irma Schrechter, would be the next logical piece. Patriot Place refinanced this year. We did manage to collect the rent from the lease at 447 Concord Road, so that was great. The little things that we've been doing there. On the program side, we have the website, which we'll look at in a minute. We offered a property manager training for income verification for all the rental managers. And so the Bedford Lip rental agents were all there. And then we just did for homeowners, deed-restricted homeowners, in a couple weeks ago at the end of May. So that was a good program offering. And then helping on projects. So we helped work on the Coast Guard RFP, should that ever go forward. And the crossing project, helping to justify the local preference and reviewing the local action unit application for the town. So I think that that's kind of a high level of the things that we did last year. Mm-hmm. And for next year, really continuing the projects in terms of the hours, because a lot of it comes down to how many hours for each town. We've added 20 hours for Bedford, but it's pretty much the same level of support. I think it's a level that works well for you.
Definitely.
So that's good. We're going to expand the website, which we'll look at in a minute. And then the IMA meant to include Burlington. The budget, it's tiny, it's really little.
It is in your Dropbox as well.
So.
Before you actually read any numbers, maybe it's a.
Yeah, I wasn't.
A large view of this. You've added one town.
You've added one town.
Adds more work for you, mm-hmm. which adds more money that needs to be spent. Mm-hmm. But in the case of any one town, let's take Bedford for instance, I don't have anything to compare this to. Is the actual amount of money that we're spending change at all? Do we, because we're now a smaller piece of a larger pie, do we end up paying slightly less than we did in the old budget?
It's a little bit higher.
Actually, a bit higher.
A little bit higher, yeah.
Because cost
of percentage is the same.
Not because of Burlington, right?
No, not because of Burlington. So the staffing, their overall billable rate went from $66 an hour to $69 an hour.
And the number of hours stayed constant, went
20
up?
20 hours more for Burlington.
20?
For Bedford.
For Bedford, I meant.
That's what I meant for Bedford. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I just wanted to understand in large scale.
Yeah. So it's similar in terms of the pricing. No big shifts. We have a third person who started this year, who's worked out very well. So in terms of who's providing all the support, and so the three of us work all part time. So I think the staffing model and the blend of support that's available to the towns is a good mix, so that no matter what kinds of things comes up, we have someone with that appropriate expertise. So that's our objective also, is to be able to have the right people for the hours. The next piece was really just about the home. I didn't realize that the public hearing was going to come first, so we don't have to really talk about that. And then the overall, the FY15, we really achieved our goals overall. We launched the website, that was one of our goals. We moved the office, we added a new community. And I think that the support that we've provided the communities, the barometer that I use is it useful and valuable? You know, is it work that you need done, that is useful to Jessica, really, she's our main contact point? And is it at a cost that's valuable to you, that makes it, and I think that we continue to deliver that for Bedford.
Really keeping all those cats corralled is very useful.
So our goals for next year are to enhance the website and to continue everything that we're doing. And any other thoughts that you might have.
Did you want to show us the?
Yes, I did. So we're very excited about this. This is a, was done by Virtual Towns and Schools, and I think you use them for your website. Very competitive pricing, I think, that, so we got the website for $4,000, so we're very happy with that. So here is, it has a little bit about the RHSO, some, you know, some text there, a little bit about the advisory committee, the interference role in our staff. We have the member towns here, so we can go here. So a little something about Bedford, a little narrative about the affordable housing in Bedford. So if you ever wanted to know, you know, what do you have for affordable housing, or if people are interested, you could always come here. How many rental units, how many ownership, you know, any of that kind of thing. We have housing picture inventory, so you can sort of see what you have here. So that's kind of a nice thing. And then we have the actual inventory. So here's your, you know, you have 16.95%, and here they all are. So if you wanted to see, okay, let's go here. So let's just see about this project. You can see a little bit more detail about it. And if we went to here, I think this is where we actually, we don't have pictures of everything, but I think here we would. So you just have a little here, and for projects that have open waiting lists, it brings you to some place where you can apply. So this would be, this is a little alert for the housing lottery for the crossing. So you can go there, and then here would be individual properties and contact information. So if you were looking for property, I want to live in Bedford, and you know, here are all the places I could go, and here's the emails and websites, and you can be directed right to someplace who could put you on the waiting list for contact. So all of these properties will accept applications. Mm-hmm. Very few units available, but at least they're the ones that will accept applications.
So a member of the general public might type in affordable housing, and this would be one of the websites that would come up.
Right. So these are all the ones in the, you know, in the whole service area. So
is it linked to each town's website?
I think we're working on that. I don't know that it's. I don't think it's. I don't think you can get here yet from Bedford.
We had Sherwood, I thought, put the link to this website on our town website, so it should be linked. And then on some of the descriptors that we added for Bedford, a lot of them link back to our website, like information about fuel assistance or the
so here we have right here
exemptions.
So we have resident services. So these are just you know, how to do the refinancing. You know, with all the instructions and the forms from DHCD, but also in here are things town-specific information. So here would be services for Bedford residents. So here would link back to the particular places in the Bedford website. So that's really what it is. I mean, it's not very deep, but it has a lot of good information. What we're looking to build off of for next year is the protected, secure site where we can deliver some of the legal documents and some of the information that we have really for Jessica, and for, you know, like more things not for the general public. So if you went to Taylor Pond, you could go over for members only, and you would go back there, and maybe there's the monitoring reports or the regulatory agreement or, you know, those kinds of things. We would also then move into the owners and the owner deeds behind the development. So if you went to Bedford Meadows,
right,
you would click there, and then there would be all the owners and their deeds. But that would be just something that only Bedford people would get into the Bedford part of that, and each town would have their own security. So it's a way for us to deliver the information that we have for you to you. So I think it would be a great thing.
The table that showed, when you showed Bedford and you showed that table initially, just go back to it for a second.
Yes.
Yeah, it's, I know if you click on each individual development, it gives you the greater detail. The SHI unit number is less helpful to people because they don't recognize, I know you said it in text, and then when you click through it, you see how many actual units are available. And since this is sort of for the public, there isn't one more column with actual affordable units, just so that people aren't discouraged. I mean, because then people might say, well, there's 200 affordable units. Why are there only, you know, so many available? Another column and say, because you have it on the detail when you click any one of those individual ones, and you explain it here, but it's not something that's really transparent to citizens of the town. So I would add, if possible, add an extra column.
It's this part right there.
Yeah, just add an extra column and say, what are the actual affordable units available at each development?
Yep.
I think that would be helpful.
Sure.
Other comments?
It's very impressive, the
monitor. Yes, it really is. Great.
The website, well, all of the services continue to be impressive.
I think it's great that you're looking into connecting this to the town's website.
Right. I'm fairly certain there's already a link on the Town of Bedford page now that will link you to the RHS website.
And probably would be a good idea on the COA and the Youth and Family Services pages as well.
So now that we have this here, it's very easy to maintain, so we can add all sorts of pieces as it seems to be useful.
Very good. So the only other piece of business we have here is an amendment to the intermunicipal agreement in order to Burlington as of July 1.
Mm-hmm. Have the other towns signed yet, or are we the first? Or?
You are almost the last. So
nice try.
So Weston is tomorrow and Sudbury is the 23rd.
That's kind of in the middle.
So I would move that the selectmen approve an agreement between the towns of Acton, Bedford, Concord, Lexington, Sudbury, and Weston, dated originally June 23rd, 2014, to share regional housing services and to incorporate the amendment dated effective July 1st, 2015.
Second.
I guess they say to include Burlington. So
moved and seconded to amend the intermunicipal agreement to include Burlington. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those abstain, 500. Thank you very much.
Three part-time workers should do great work.
Okay, we're getting this down. Next on our agenda is contract approval for fiscal year 16 for Elliott Human Services.
Hello.
How are you? Didn't even have to read the memo to know that it was from you.
Me too.
It's just adding a little smile to your day.
I got a dog.
You like, I know.
You got a dog? Uh-huh. Okay.
All right. I'm so glad that you're all smiling. You know me. I'm here. Some of you may not know Deborah Garfield, the Elliott Clinic Director, who's here with me. And she's been coming the last several years we've done this. And it's been actually 2 years since we did this. This is the second time I think we've done a 2-year contract at the suggestion of town council and kind of in looking at it. So although it's always a pleasure to see you, you know, we haven't seen you on this contract for a couple of years. The contract is for FY16 and FY17 and remains virtually the same as in all the previous years. There's really no change in it. It's been updated with detailed legal requirements from our town council, which, you know, Elliot responded to, and so it seems to be current in terms of the agreement, as far as I can tell. You, in your packet, you should have a copy of the RFP we sent out, as well as the service proposal that Elliot submitted, and then the agreement that you will be signing, you'll be asked to sign tonight if you so choose. And then we did a statistics package that has the FY14 data about the contract for the whole year, and then we did an FY15 to date that just has the three quarters on it, and then graphs that shows that we're providing pretty much the same level of service that we have. We have had, I think, 5 clinicians this year. We're currently down a clinician. 2 clinicians have been working in the school, and we have 3 clinicians working out of the office. And we're looking to hire one other clinician to fill the gap that was created in end of April. So we still expect about the same level of service throughout the next 2 years that you would be approving this contract. So I'm not sure if there are other questions. I feel like I've presented this contract to you, and because it remains unchanged, I'm not sure how much more you might want to know about it. I know maybe, Carolyn, is this new for you?
This is new for me.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So others on the board have seen this before. So we can entertain any questions that you might have based on the materials that you've got. And Deb is here to help me answer anything. And
you can sing or dance, just so.
I dance. I don't sing.
I do think the charts are an interesting view to show the consistency of service, variations from time to time, but basically the contract amount, as far as the monetary value from the town and to the town, has been very consistent, mm-hmm. and the service clients seen, readmission, all the statistics are very consistent as well, but certainly.
Well, I guess my question was sort of going to be to that point, which is that I've read through and I agree with what Mark said about the consistency and sort of the value for what we're getting. But I guess the one question that I would have is that, you track in terms of the clients that are served, but I wonder what the waiting list looks like and if there are people who are not being served and if the number of hours in this contract is actually sufficient.
Usually we don't carry a long waiting list. When there is a staff vacancy, then there is a waiting list. And right now there is a waiting list because we have a vacancy. But normally we really, our goal is to be responsive, is to kind of get people seen as quickly as possible. And the clinical staff has been very responsive to that in general. Right now there is a waiting list, and that's unusual for us to have this. And so that's something that Deb and I have talked about, and I don't know if there's anything more you want to say about that.
I think I'm trying to think of how many people are on the waiting list right now. Some of it is when the clinician left, the third clinician left, so some of those cases are transfer cases. And so one of the things that we try to do is we always will say to people that if they really want to be seen, if I don't have anybody in Bedford, we'll ask that, would they like to, if they would like to come to Concord, if I can accommodate them in that way. And certainly we make the other services that we have available, such as our psychopharm services. We don't wait until someone is seen in Bedford. They can come to Concord like they normally would to get that particular type of service, because we don't offer that in Bedford. So we try to figure out if there's other things that people who are waiting, if we can do for them in the metro. Thank
you. If I read the graphs correctly, you have about 4 times as many people don't show up as you actually serve. Do you have any thoughts about that?
It is an issue, and it's something that that the clinicians have grappled with for a while. And I'm not really sure sort of why the no-show rate is so high, because I think about our clinic, and I think it's a little bit higher than in our clinic, and I don't know if some of it has to do with that not that people don't take it as seriously, but I think it's something that they feel like maybe they don't have to call, because again, it's in the Bedford Youth and Town offices, and so it feels a little different. I'm not sure, we've never been able to really get a good handle on why that is.
Do people that no-show once actually ultimately show?
Yes, yes.
So some of the no-shows ultimately get served?
I would say probably 90% of the no-shows are served. I think that they don't come for an appointment or two. People are pretty good about it. If people consistently no-show a couple of times and then we've never seen them, you know, we do outreach efforts and then we stop. Because if they don't want service right now, that's fine. They can come back. But most of the no-shows are people who are in treatment and have been seen.
Oh, okay.
That's good. Because I read that.
Because the graph doesn't tell you that, so.
Right, sure.
They are lumped together. And I know last winter was a particularly challenging winter. I mean, if school is canceled, then parents.
Those all count as no-shows.
Yeah, right. So they, again, they are lumped together. It's not broken down. So it could be a cancellation or a no-show. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Any questions? Comments?
Nope.
No?
Dame broke.
I say, valuable ongoing service, for sure.
Well, that's how we feel about it. So yeah. We really appreciated your support of it all these years, you know, like 25 years or something. So it's been a long-standing relationship.
So we have in front of us an agreement which would need to be approved.
I move we approve the selectmen approve the agreement between the town of Bedford and Elliott Community Human Services for a period of 2 years commencing July 1st, 2015 through June 30th, 2017.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those abstained, 500. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see you, even if it is biannually. All right. Next on our agenda is a committee appointment interview for the Volunteer Coordinating Committee, of which we are in search of the two added members that resulted from bylaw change and town meeting action. So, Mr. O'Connor.
Mr. Chairman. It's not nearly, as I see it, as heavy lifting as what capital expenditures was growing into or becoming. There's a lot more with the new system than in the old days, the knuckle-dragging days. I believe that the volunteer committee has a very social element to it, and social being, who do you know, who can you meet?
To their schedule, but yet their value on the committee is huge. So how will you portray that as a positive, to have people get involved and give up their nights? Which is something that I hear a lot, that people have great intentions and want to be and come involved in all the same circles that you talked about. But it's...
Selectman, I believe that if we go back to President Kennedy, when he said, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. Just get in their faces with an approach shot that if we have to, guilt the heck out of them and say, let's get into this. My approach shot might be a little different than some of yours, but being able to talk to them and find out where their strengths are. You're not going to put someone that's, you know, you're not going to put me into FinCom. I just don't do numbers. It's not a good match. You have to know who the movers and the shakers are and who's going to be able to, and just approach them with something that's how meaningful it is and the value. Was there a second question?
No, you answered both together.
Okay. Caroline, what's
question?
The...
Okay.
What's the... can you give a quick summary of what the situation is now with vacancies? Yeah, I mean, you implied that there was a...
I don't know that I could do that. I know that there are at least 10 or 12.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Doesn't have to be that specific. Just
Colleen supports
yes.
It just sounded like it was like exacerbated. It was.
It's not as bad as it was.
Last year was worse. Mm-hmm. This year there is 2 on trails, 1 on community preservation. I think there's 2 on CapEx, and then there's 1 on FinCom at the FinCom Appointing Authorities meeting in 2 weeks.
2 weeks, right.
I'm trying to think about it. Transportation's going to have 2, but we have 1 person can't make it this week, but it's coming on the 22nd.
And they're long-standing, some of them are long-standing vacancies,
trails
which
we're waiting on
particularly
an updated
is
charge.
Mm-hmm.
So once the Trails Committee has their updated charge, we'll be able to fill those vacancies.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they've presented it to the Conservation Commission. We're just waiting to hear back from that. I think that's the biggest long-standing mm-hmm. one. And I think that's it.
So these sound like pretty attractive. Well, you know,
absolutely.
I mean, they for people who have certain inclinations. Osea, is there are there other ways to publicize these things? That I mean, the our media of publicity have changed over the years, and one thing that I'm not aware of, unfortunately, is just how many listservs are out there that are just Bedford based. It's like a Yahoo group, and
you dating yourself, man.
I know. I mean, there's probably a lot of them, people talking to each other that way.
I can speak to what we're doing currently, and if I'm missing something, feel free to jump in. But I do know that we're going through multiple media. We're going through the schools. We're going through the PTAs. We're going through the sports organizations. So we're being creative as we can, reaching out to various groups. Through most of what we know is out there to use, mm-hmm. Without becoming a pest about some balance to
right.
what we do in the time.
Being tweeted every day right. saying, "Are you sure you don't want to volunteer?"
We don't tweet every other day.
I guess I would just mm-hmm. say that I think that there's limitations to the broadcast mm-hmm. model, and a lot of what the committee does is that person to person, and matching of interest and skills that you perceive, or someone says something, some offhand remark about something that they're interested in, and you happen to know there's an opening on a committee that they would like, right? So I think that the success of the committee in its expanded form really does rely on a combination of the broadcast methods through the media that exists and new media as it becomes available, but that person-to-person contact, picking up the phone and reaching out to people. And that's why I think it's so important to have a diversity of people on the volunteer coordinating mm-hmm. committee mm-hmm. so that they can work different networks instead mm-hmm. of the same network, which I think sometimes the broadcasts reach, I might get that email 5 times. Have you considered volunteering? But there might be someone out there who doesn't get it at all.
It's a question of, okay, let's identify what's available. A brief synopsis of what it might be in what might be involved with those positions, and there's a certain skill sets that may be required or at least appreciated. There's always that person to person, and there's one person that has a Twitter account. There's how to ask the people, hey, Bobby, hey, Elizabeth, hey, Joanne, hey, Greg, who would come to mind of the people that you know? It's shaking the trees that way, and then those people become ambassadors as well in a multiple pronged approach to getting people involved. and it's a persistence, for sure. Does anyone remember about 8 years ago when we were able to count how many essays were turned in, Memorial Day essays were turned in on one hand? You do.
5 or 6. 3.
And then there was a persistence. And it wasn't, 2 weeks before Memorial Day, and it wasn't conversations with people just on Veterans Day. It was, hi, how are you? It's good to see you. And then, did you see what was going on? We really appreciate this. Frank Sinks, you guys are in politics. It's really politics. At a local level, people for these other jobs. You don't just go out and tell everybody to vote for you at before some Tuesday and when we do it, November?
Saturday in March.
Yeah, it's good. Oh, yeah, there were some cold, windy days there.
Should we tweet you the day before?
Did you?
No, we didn't talk about tweeting the day before at all.
Did you have any other?
It's multi-pronged.
I'm good.
You're good? Okay. We're all good. So, no, I'm just trying to keep things moving along. So, two things I just want to make sure we're clear on. One is we need to recount the, would you like me to do this or would you like to do this?
I see that you've written down your little list.
I just wrote down a little list of things that we make sure to remind anyone who comes before us seeking appointment are that if you are appointed, you will receive a copy of the ethics statute, and there is an online ethics quiz that anyone appointed to town, state, regional, any public bodies are now required to take from time to time. You'll also receive a copy of the conflict of interest law. Not really clear exactly how conflict of interest might play into this, but you never know. Presumably, family members maybe. I'm not sure what would happen if you were a member of the volunteer committee. However, if you did ever come across something and you had any question about it, there are resources, including town manager and town council, so that we can always make sure that everybody is following conflict of interest law appropriately. A reminder on the open meeting law. So volunteer coordinating committee meetings are subject to the open meeting law. I know you're somewhat familiar with that because of CapEx. But the real reminder is discussions via email are a violation of the open meeting law. So information, schedules, things like that are distributable that way, but not conversations amongst members, because the conversations need to happen in open meetings. And then the last, of course, is a reminder that the town does follow a set of civil discourse rules. Most notably in the back of town meeting warrants, of course, but just as a matter of course, volunteer coordinating committee members may be interviewing people who think they're perfect for something, may have strong opinions about that. The committee itself, of course, needs to conduct itself appropriately and treat everyone with the same level of respect that they would expect for themselves. Those are the four reminders. We are at the very beginning of the selectman process for this. You know, the volunteer coordinating committee is not seeking members for itself and then recommending them to us. So we're advertising, we're waiting to hear from other members, other applicants. And so I don't think we're in a position to do anything this evening. We have two positions and we appreciate that you are the first to come forward. Process may take us a little while, but we certainly appreciate that you're here. Any other thoughts or comments?
Nope.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Our next agenda item was another appointment interview. Unfortunately, Kenneth Casey Ackerman had a family situation for this evening, so he's been rescheduled for our next meeting on the 22nd. So we're going to pass over that item. And we're on to committee reappointments, for which we have a list of all of the interested reappointments for various committees that would take effect on July 1st.
I have a question.
All right, then.
My question has to do with what was mentioned just a few minutes ago about the Trails Committee, and it's waiting for an update on its charge. And I also seem to recall that there were problems with body count. That there were, you know, who was part of the committee and who wasn't. The number was looking right, like it was 8, and it really ought to be an odd number. And so, does that influence in any way these reappointments? Should they be held off? Because of that?
So my understanding is that the confusion has to do with the Conservation Commission and the Trails Committee, and that long ago, the Trails Committee was a subcommittee of the Conservation Commission, except that the Conservation Commission doesn't really have the ability to establish a subcommittee of...
Sure, I know Andre Sutoff was that person, but he resigned, so Tom has to recommend someone else for it.
Right.
But I'm not sure when that's going to happen, or they're going to wait until this charge is approved.
So the terms on this committee, I believe, are 1 year, am I correct?
It's an ad hoc.
Every year, the whole committee is reappointed. So right now, what we're looking at here are five positions, people who all are being reappointed. That still leaves...
None of whom are members of the Conservation Commission.
Yes, I'm looking at that. And so it still leaves, depending upon whether the, if we wanted to get to an odd number, if we wanted to shrink the committee to seven or expand the committee to nine, it still leaves flexibility to do that.
So this is not...
There are five.
Not creating a problem.
Correct.
That's all, that was my main point.
Right. There are five members here.
Okay.
And yes, Conservation can have a liaison. We could have a liaison.
But are they...
They're
not a voting member of the committee. They're simply a liaison to the committee, so that if there were questions for Conservation, that person can take that back and forth between Trails and Conservation. Now...
We will check the charge and make up of the committee to make sure that... I don't believe the Selectmen's a voting member of the Trails Committee, but I'm not sure about the Conservation Commission. We can check that.
I'm just reading from this memo from the Volunteer Coordinating Committee of September of 2014. It says the current number of appointed at-large members is five. The Selectmen reappointed all of those members back in June of 2014. I guess here they are again.
Mm-hmm.
In addition, the Conservation Commission has a representative. The Land Stewards has a representative. The DPW has a non-voting representative. And the Bicycle Advisory Committee and Recreation Commission are not presently represented. So I guess the original count was supposed to be four members at large, not five, according to the original charge. If I read this memo.
What was the other vote? Conservation?
Five members at large.
Yeah, five members at large.
Conservation has a representative. That's a voting person. Land Stewards has a representative. And the Bicycle Advisory Committee and the Recreation Commission are not presently represented.
Right. So that would be seven members. If CONCOM and Land Stewards are both members.
If one does not appoint anybody additional.
Correct.
Like Bicycle or Recreation.
So you said, is the charge being reviewed and these things are going to be added and then we'll be asked to appoint? Is that the situation?
That's
or do
what I'm
we
asking.
Do we not know?
When the Volunteer Coordinating Committee first started researching this, we could never find the original charge. The Conservation Department didn't have it. We checked old Selectmen's minutes and there was never an official charge anywhere that we could find. So this is kind of based off the past history of appointments.
Okay.
So that's what they've been doing. And I think, like I said, it's with the Conservation Commission right now. And I guess we're waiting to hear what they think in terms of numbers. And
so I guess what Bill's question is should we hold off on appointing those five just in case there's some change in the charge that means that they don't want that number of at-large or some other configuration?
But then to come all the way back to the beginning, this is a Selectman-appointed committee. So if we have an opinion about the charge, we're the ones who appoint these folks.
True, but they may make a good argument for the charge being different or the...
But would the charge being different or any revisiting of any of the positions that Bill was just mentioning affect these five?
Could if they reduced them.
What if they came back and said, Trails Committee is too big, we only want five members?
The question this memo seems to beg is, does one want to have the Bicycle Advisory Committee...
Yes.
And the Recreation Commission
on
the committee? If you do, then you're at eight.
Unless they're just non-voting.
Unless one of them's non-voting.
So I attended a meeting, per, I believe, the selectman's preference at one point 6 months ago, that included trails, conservation. Adrian was there. And they discussed what their wishes were with the, for the future for the charge. The action item was left that Trails was going to develop a charge that we couldn't, you know, locate, and that conservation and the other positions, bicycle, recreation, would be liaisons, not voting members. And information would pass, just as you described it. I don't know the date of that memo. I don't know who wrote that.
This goes back to September of last year.
Okay, so since then, I feel like the action is with the Trails Committee. There was absolutely no talk of decreasing the number, certainly of these five. I think that they were all in agreement at that meeting.
I want to make it clear, I'm not opposed to these five people. I just want to make
sure. No, I know that.
We don't create a problem for ourselves.
I guess my fear would be, we're creating a problem by not voting on those.
That's true. I mean, presumably, if they have not yet finished writing their charge, and we're at the first week of June, second week of June, we may want to reappoint all these people, just because it may take them a while to get back to us with their presumably new, different composition.
I just raised the question, that's all.
Okay.
So I guess what I'm hearing is, we're not, we don't have a problem with these, with the five positions being filled tonight.
Other comments or questions? Yes.
Couple of things. Rick, I don't know if you can answer this. Are we sure that Brad Hafer will be coming back on fiscal planning and coordinating as he's stepping down as school committee chair tomorrow night?
Who's going to be the new chair?
Mike McAllister. I mean, that might be one we want to hold off on until we know.
Who the second school committee member would be.
The other thing is, I don't know if this can be answered either, but I'd be interested to see a list of people who declined reappointment.
I have that. I can use
that. That would be very interesting. Because sometimes, occasionally, I've seen people decline reappointment who I think, personally, have a lot of potential, and they might need to be put on somebody's list for future recruitment for town service.
Something else.
Because sometimes the reason for their decision is more narrow than would preclude coming back in another capacity.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you.
Other thoughts or questions?
I guess make a comment. I appreciate continuing the museum study committee. I don't anticipate it lasting really beyond July, but we do need to reconstitute at least to get into July.
Mm-hmm.
And I expect to have the work done there very shortly. We're very close.
Great.
Okay.
At least in terms of what will be reported.
Mm-hmm. We may have more work for them, though.
Move motion.
Sure, yeah. If there are no other comments or questions, yes. Well, I guess with the exception of Brad Hafer,
Move Selectman approve the incumbent reappointments as listed in the memorandum dated June 4th, 2015, with the exception of Brad Hafer on the Fiscal Planning and Coordinating Committee.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstain, 500.
Oh, good.
Only 75.
Only 75.
Great.
Pass
That's
them
what
down.
Ed Norton always did.
Before he played the piano.
Don't hoard them, pass them down.
Where's yes, don't hoard them. 10 at a time, 5 at a time.
All right, next item, a series of Chapter 268A, Section 20B exemptions.
Move Selectman approve waivers of Mass General Laws, Chapter 268A, Section 20B for the following: Jacqueline Barmashi, Amber Beasy, Megan Beasy, Devin Duncan, Zena Changelian, Nico Kulowitzki, Jessica Hamm, Ben Richter, Neil Looktie, Jeffrey Taylor, Parker Taggart, Benjamin Weber.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the Chapter 26A, 268A exemptions. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstained, 500. All right, and then we have a draft tax letter.
Can I speak on that, Mr. Chair?
Yes, please.
There's no, the information that you have is provides a guideline as to the nature of the communication. The letter hasn't been written yet, but what we're looking for is just endorsement of the subject. That's what the other boards have done. HATS really can't issue an opinion unless it's endorsed by the member boards. We basically just want to support these various projects that are coming before the MPU.
Well, I know we did bring up the subject of the Route 4225 improvements in Lexington and ask to have some sort of line of communication opened between us and Lexington regarding what they're planning. And obviously this little narrative about the putting on the 2021-2025 long-range plan gives us some sense of when this work is being anticipated. And, you know, I guess we could go ahead and support it in concept and work out the details in practice, but it strikes me that there may be some things about this that we don't like. You know, I don't know necessarily that I feel entirely comfortable endorsing it when this is one of the action items that we have in front of us to do something about in terms of molding it and making sure that it doesn't have negative consequences for Bedford. So I'm of two minds about it because I think it is important for us to play nicely with our HATS neighbors, but on the other hand, I think this is an opportunity for us to open up this discussion with Lexington.
So Mike, can you talk about, or maybe Rick, you can talk about the timing necessary for what's going on here? We're being asked to be supportive of these descriptions of these projects, but this is part of the long range. They're asking for the one that Margot is talking about to include it in the long range plan. So when does that all happen? When does the plan get completed? When are these comments due?
I have that schedule right in front of me. So
the letter that is being written is in general terms. I don't believe that these plans are down to specific components. Basically, the letter will say that the selectmen that have supports improvements to the 4 and 225 corridor in Lexington.
Well, I mean, it's been many years now since they presented some pretty detailed plans for a series of rotaries or roundabouts now, I can't remember. And their idea of what would improve the level of service at that intersection for them, without necessarily much coordination with what that will do to us in terms of the Great Road where the lane narrows and also the intersection of South and Springs. And so I just don't want to find ourselves in the position of having endorsed something and then having to stand up and object to it. Mm-hmm. And maybe we do need an update at very least on what has happened since that initial meeting that we had with Lexington 7 years ago.
So I guess as a practical matter, what we're really being asked to do is to agree to a four-town HATS letter that describes the four towns' support for these projects.
Yes, but it's in the context of HATS. It's not a although implicit in that is that the four towns sanction.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, we want them to be supportive of the Middlesex Turnpike Phase 3.
Yep, and any future projects, bikeway. Look, if we don't approve this tonight and there's no HAZ letter, nothing's going to change. The HAZ letter is not going to influence things one way or the other. What could change, even subliminally, is future relationships. I would ask that we vote it in and then pursue the details, maybe a little more aggressively.
Mike, do you think that it would be possible to just add a very simple phrase or statement subject to final review of traffic impacts from the design like that would allow a little bit of wiggle room to
change your mind.
All the four municipalities to
But this is sort of the HATS is sort of one of the venues that we have to come together to talk about how we coordinate and manage the impacts across our communities.
It's actually not a surprise to the town of Lexington that we have that concern, because it was noted when it was presented at our Transportation Advisory Committee, and they showed us the traffic counts and back, you know, the queuing that would take place to enter the rotary. And
that was
one area where there could potentially be.
Yeah, but those numbers are.
It was quite a while ago.
And now the traffic situation is even, you know, much worse along Hartwell Avenue and coming into the center of Bedford than it was at that time. So, I mean, I agree with you, Mike, completely in terms of solidarity and collaboration for important projects to the group of towns, but this particular project has the potential to be extremely challenging for our town, and I just want to use due caution in endorsing something that may wind up becoming the bane of our existence.
And I guess I have to say that the opposite of what you said is also true, which is that if there's no letter from Pat's, the towns are going to do what the towns want to do in order to advocate for the projects to be placed in the plan. But if we vote in favor of allowing HATS to say collectively we're all in favor of it, then we are potentially boxing ourselves into a position by having allowed a multi-town letter to go in, which may in fact have an impact. That all four towns agreed on all of the projects that are listed here. But we may not, in fact, want this project to go without knowing more about how exactly it would be going, or what the impacts will be, which we don't know now.
I think the intent is to support the projects, not necessarily, and we don't even know at this point what every detail is. If you support the project, then you're in a position. You're in a better position to negotiate those details. I think there certainly is one aspect of the project that we know will benefit Bedford, and that's the roundabout plan for McGuire Road, which includes heavy Bedford traffic, some of it feeding the industrial corridor and Wiggins Avenue. That's part of this project. By not endorsing it, I think implicit is that we don't want to see improvement at all, or could be interpreted that way.
Can't we vote that we support subject two and add a subject two to it?
Not the letter is supposed to be from the four towns.
Well, I mean, I think this draws attention to one of the downsides to being in an organization that requires consensus among four towns. That we're the only one who has an interest in this project that's in conflict with our neighboring town. Lincoln doesn't care, right? You know, so it is a drawback of this model that we can't be supportive and yet reserve the right to complain about it at the same time.
All right, well, so
I still think we could write something subject to.
The other towns didn't have that component.
Yeah, I was going to say, we're not the ones who are going to end up writing the letter.
It's unified language across all the towns.
Isn't this still, though, very much a draft, Mike?
Well, the...
Isn't there an essence that you're supposed to go back and discuss?
Oh, the letter?
Yeah.
No, I have to, it has to be written and submitted, because there won't be another HATS meeting until the end of July, and the intent was to write it and submit it right away, because I believe there was an imminent deadline for this kind of comment.
Well, so there's at least some hesitation. Do we have a sense one way or the other here? Mike, I know you would like us to do this. Margot's raised some issues. I'm of a mind to agree with Margot. I'm not eager to agree to a letter for these projects as they've been presented to us at this time.
One that we haven't seen.
Has the DPW had any further updates on this that we haven't been made aware of? I mean, there's certainly aspects of it that, you know, we would endorse continuing our work together on the bike path and the shuttle bus and other aspects of this project and why it's important.
The letter basically bullet points the projects,
right,
and says that HATS endorses these being acted upon favorably by the MPO. And that's it. It's like a one-page letter with bullet points. I think all of these have details. I mean, the Route 2 Rotary, you know, that's in another stratosphere. Nobody even knows how they're going to deal with that, but we want it on there.
So are you saying that all of this project detail is not going to be included in the letter?
Not in the letter that I was planning to write on behalf of HATS. It's just going to be a list, a general list of these are the topics that HATS thinks should move forward without any detail. I would hope we would agree that we need to improve that Bedford Street corridor. We may or may not think a roundabout is a good way, but certainly what they have now is dangerous and not necessarily helpful to traffic flow.
I think the problem, at least the problem I'm having, is that having seen conceptual plans that Lexington's interested in pursuing, it's hard for me to separate out that a letter from the four towns that names that project as one of the bullets isn't referring to what we've already seen, because we haven't seen anything else and haven't heard any kind of an update in a couple of years since they came out and did a relatively informal meeting with just a transportation advisory committee. They've never been in front of us. We haven't seen any plan beyond that. So I understand what you're saying, that the plan is for a letter that is not project specific, but it implies a project that people already have in their minds, which includes multiple roundabouts and if I remember correctly, a separated median the entire length of Bedford Street there at that section, and a rerouting of traffic to be able to go back into the interchange and come back out again, or through a rotary roundabout this side of the median.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I the more we talk about it, the less inclined I am.
Well, I'm not going to propose it so that it can be defeated.
Something to put it in.
Oh,
but I will inform the, I would hope that the response would be a more aggressive communication between the two towns in terms of just what the impact would be, so that we can act on it with some knowledge. And I'm not sure whether it would take a traffic study or who's going to pay for that, but otherwise it's just really conjecture.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we either need to take an action or move on to another agenda item.
I'll motion.
All right.
So So what?
So.
If we did something, what is it that we, at this point, after all that discussion, what is it that it would be recommended we, not recommended, but what is it that you think that we need to vote?
Well, I was just going to move that the selectmen endorse HATS. The selectmen endorse a HATS communication to the MPO delineating various local projects in a favorable inclusion on the long-range plan. And that was the substance of the motion and of the letter, but sounds like that is dead on arrival.
Well, it depends on what the description is of the interchange of Hartwell and Bedford Road. Whether it says some solution, or it says existing solutions, or specifically calls out traffic circles.
The letter wasn't going to be specific about any of the details of these projects, but only delineate the individual projects without any detail.
I get the impression, Mark, from your statement that as a planner, you've seen things get engraved in stone that weren't intended necessarily.
No, I just think that we're at a disadvantage when we don't have the actual letter, and when it is in fact referring to a project for which we've had only a conceptual presentation, and it raised issues for Bedford,
yep.
And Lexington continues to steam ahead because they believe in it, which I understand, but that doesn't mean that we necessarily need to sign on yet. And I'm just concerned that this is an indication that we're signing on.
And Mike, I infer from what you say, it's all or nothing.
Yeah, because we don't really have any flexibility since Lincoln and Concord have already taken a vote. I don't have the language of their vote. I didn't anticipate that this would be an issue, or else I would have brought it up at the HATS meeting. But I'm not concerned about the impact or lack of impact of the letter, but only on the relationship that we might have with Lexington now and in the future. So I think that we need to follow up on it in some context, whether we invite them in to make a presentation or collaborate with them at the staff level.
I think we absolutely need to find a way to collaborate with them, because I think they're producing their plans not entirely in a vacuum, but certainly not taking into consideration the effects on us. And I think that has already been flagged as something that we need some action on, and we had been in a holding pattern for a long time, and now this, you know, unfortunately, you know, time sensitively for something that's happening in, you know, the next decade, has come up at an inopportune moment when we hadn't yet taken those actions, but we certainly need to. And thinking about how exactly we want to coordinate and what we want out of Lexington in terms of traffic studies, planning collaboration, whatever, I think is entirely the point. And until I know that, I think that's mm-hmm. where I have reservations about this, because those things haven't happened.
Can our concerns go back to HATS as feedback?
There isn't any point because it'll be too late. But I think that the main thing is to make sure that there's that Lexington doesn't interpret this as obstructionist or.
Well, my most recent conversation with one of the Lexington selectmen was it was clear that several of us have been speaking back and forth about the need for Lexington and Bedford to talk about what the improvements for the Bedford Street corridor and the Hartwell Ave corridor look like in their minds, and how we get to have some input into however that may or may not play out. It'll be years before there's funding available, except that Lexington appears to be preparing to tap resources they're gaining from development that's happening on Hartwell Avenue and their own funds in order to start down the path of some of these improvements. I'm sorry, but that only makes me
You're already.
Continued, yeah, that only continues to make me nervous about simply signing on and saying we're part of the four towns, so we're in favor of anything any of the four towns want to do. And I would take no offense if we had some project that they were concerned about and didn't want to sign off early and often either. So I guess I don't really see how we can endorse the letter. And it wouldn't be the first time, perhaps, to have a member that didn't endorse what the others wanted to do, and that's part of the structure of what we signed on for. So.
All right, well, let's hope that this will lead to
communication.
Some answers.
Communication.
All right, next item on our agenda is the regular session minutes from May 26th. Want to start, Caroline? Do you have any?
I did not have any. Nope.
Marga? Notes? Amendments?
He wasn't here, but I have just one English language correction I'd like to suggest. On page 4, under 15266, the used car dealership, in the first paragraph, third last line, or second, fourth last line, cars can be purchased the cheapest in November, December, yet sell the most in the spring and summer. I put a period there and delete the word hence why and insert the words as a result, comma, and change after 100 cars the word packed to parked.
Although packed is,
well, packed would also be
packed. Down the boss and they'd be packed.
Okay.
But up here they probably be parked.
It's West Bedford.
So, Marga.
Yeah, let me say this about that.
I don't have any corrections.
Okay.
Mike? Page 2, 3 paragraphs up from the bottom line, it talks about the revenue,
right.
Tommy Ardwell, period. And then, new sentence, this year the equipment generates revenue of
$151,300. Right. Did you get that?
Just sort of in.
Period after meeting
Article,
meeting Article 12.
Meeting Article 12. And
period.
Then basically invert that sentence so it says the equipment generated $151,300 in revenue this year.
Okay.
Page 4. 15-220-266 used car dealership license. Second line, the property of 50 Concord Road that is currently a towing operation into a car dealership. It's not currently anything. Is it permitted as a towing operation or
yes.
Grandfathered as a towing? What's the verb that we want?
We've granted a license for a repair shop with
so it's
possibility of using a tow truck.
So it's currently licensed as a towing operator.
The license of selectment control was for a used car.
A used car dealership.
There's a previous special permit issued.
Permitted.
Oh, right. A special permit for that.
That pertains to the towing.
Yeah, so I just wanted to insert that because it, I don't remember whether there was ever actually a towing operation there. But it's permitted for one.
Mm-hmm.
That's all for me.
Okay. So currently permitted for
a towing operation, yeah.
By the zoning board.
By the zoning board of appeals, right. Yeah.
It was actually.
Any other comments? A motion for the amended minutes?
Move selectmen approve the minutes of May 26, 2015 as amended.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain. 401. And executive session minutes.
Caroline wasn't in the meeting, so she can't have been roll called for adjourning the executive session.
I didn't even get them.
I didn't even look at them, so I didn't notice that.
Good point.
I did not say aye.
Any other comments? A motion to approve the executive session minutes?
Move we approve the executive session minutes of May 26th.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain? 401.
Nope, two.
Two.
Oh, I'm sorry, 302. Sorry. And we are on to town manager's report. Mr. Reed.
So I wanted to mention two things tonight. First, unfortunately, over the weekend, there was some minor vandalism down at Springsbrook Park. Appears to have occurred Saturday evening. There may be some local news coverage of it just because somebody heard about it and thought, you know, they should tell a story about it. So you're aware of it. From the reports from the recreation director, the damage is not major, but people tried to get into the building and were rattling doors and disconnected the dock from the anchors that hold it to the shore and some few things like that. So, also, I just wanted to mention that town council has informed us that he is not going to seek reappointment for July 1st because he has accepted a full-time position serving as the city solicitor in Attleboro, which is the next municipality over from his hometown of North Attleboro. So he's leaving the firm of Murphy, Hesse, Toomey, Lehane, and going to be a full-time employee at City of Attleboro. So therefore, he cannot continue to do work for us. And it's he indicated, he told me about this, that it was mostly a lifestyle choice for him because he's going to be earning less money, but he won't be commuting every day to Quincy or other places to represent other clients. So sorry to see him go. He's worked for us for the last 3.5 years. Although we have had many other attorneys at Murphy, Hesse, Toomey, and Lehane work with us, that support the council himself, and plus the firm itself has represented the town since 1993. So would like to know how the selectmen would like to proceed on filling the vacancy. It's my belief that we've been well served by Murphy, Hesse, Toomey, and Lehane, and that one of the other attorneys in the firm, who is Brandon Moss, who would be interested in being appointed here, is willing to serve, and I believe he'd be a good choice. So, but this is a selectman's appointment, so if you know how you'd like to proceed. At a minimum, if we thought we could make a final decision before the end of the year, I'd like to at least have an interim appointment for a transition period.
I think it's probably worth noting it's an annual appointment of a specific individual. So we will need to do something, whether it's interim or long term, at our next meeting in order to maintain access to town council services. So that's just something to keep in mind. I think, Rick, you indicated in here that we could have the suggested member of Murphy Hesse here at our next meeting if that would be useful to everyone. But I'll open it so we can talk about what we want to do next.
I have no problem with what Rick was talking about. I have a conflict that's been in the works for 2 years, which is I will be out of town at our next meeting. And I'd like very much to be part of the process. So I'd like very much, with the consent of the fellow selectmen, to delay interviewing for one meeting to the July 6th meeting and have you, for us tonight, vote to have an interim agreement so that we could pursue it as a group and not just the four of you.
I would like to just talk through with Brandon a vote to appoint him as an interim. I didn't anticipate potentially doing that tonight.
Right.
He does not know about that.
Well, it's not on our agenda, actually, so we can't actually take that action, so.
But it sounds like, Bill, you're saying that your preference would be not to make any permanent decision, but that to go ahead with the interim would be fine for our next meeting.
If you could just wait one meeting, that would be wonderful, from my standpoint.
Okay. Other thoughts or concerns about any of the process so far? I mean.
The memo that Rick gave us about some other law firms that specialize in municipal law, but the potential for conflicts because they represent our neighboring towns, now that we've had this long discussion about one of our neighboring towns. I certainly can understand how that would be detrimental. I just wonder, you know, I know Brandon has done work as sort of the backup for Attorney Mangiarati for us in the past, but are there any other attorneys from Murphy, Hess, Toomey, and Lehane who might be interested, against whom we can compare his qualifications or anything? I mean, he seems like a great guy, and I'm sure that we've been happy with what he's done for us.
Not nearly as senior as anybody we've had before.
Correct. I mean, considering that
There are some other
Mr. Lehane before him.
Much more senior parties at the firm still there. However, they are likely to only be there for, you know, a year or two, because they're of an age where they're going to be retiring themselves. And I think from a long-term perspective, this is the most sensible choice. I think that there are other attorneys who have done good work for us within the firm, but none of them have worked as much as Brandon has, as sort of like a second level attorney in the firm, reporting and coordinated through Town Council Mangiarati. So Brandon Moss has done a substantial amount of work, and most of the activity that we tend to have is land-based law, which is what Brandon has usually done for us. So he's the one that's been behind all of that to a large extent, reviewed, of course, by Town Council Mangiarati at the time. And Town Council Mangiarati himself recommends Brandon as an excellent choice.
So the only thing that concerns me about the interim is how long an interim period, I'm not sure exactly what that means.
I think you just leave it indefinite appointment, essentially, until
we confirm him as the permanent, or appoint somebody else.
And I guess my point would be then, and maybe this is for you, Bill, because I mean, personally, I'm not uncomfortable with where this could go, simply appointing. And I understand that you would like to be there, but the other way to do that would be to leave that the remaining members could appoint him, but I think it's necessary for him to come to us. We have periodically had annual presentations of existence of pending litigation, discussions of cases. I think we could even, in this case, expand that so that we could make sure, if we have questions or issues with any of the past cases, some of which have had various twists and turns, we could have a full discussion with him about both existing and...
These would be on the July 6th Selectman's agenda for recommendation from the Selectman.
Okay.
Are we going to put together a rotation list for FinCom? I don't know that we've done that in a while.
We haven't done it in a while.
I will not be available to go to this one, so anybody should feel free to drop in.
So that's...
This Thursday.
We're also discussing our fiscal policies document to see if we would like to make changes to it, which may or may not be of interest to you.
Always of interest, Ben.
You're fascinating.
And sometimes we're just boring, so...
That's all I had for this time period.
Well, I was just going to tell a cute story, but I don't know if it's appropriate now. I don't want to break the mood. This was last week's Historical Preservation Commission meeting, our town historian Sharon McDonald recounted an experience that I thought was cute. When they open up the Joe Blaine House to third grade tours, Sharon gets dressed up in her colonial outfit, you know, she's, we can all picture that, and she said, as she greeted the arriving students, one young man was just incredulous. He raced up to her and said, "You're still alive?"
Oh.
That's all I got.
That's so encouraging.
Okay.
I'm not following him.
Anything, Margot?
Yeah, but it's just, I don't know, how do you follow that?
You can't really.
You can't. Okay, I've got really dry stuff. The Zoning Board of Appeals had an interesting discussion at their last meeting concerning the memo that we did receive from our current, soon-to-be former town council concerning teardowns on non-conforming lots. So essentially what all the role is of the ZBA in monitoring and regulating already non-conforming situations. And I know that this is something that in some of our smaller neighborhoods, we've seen dramatic changes in the size and massing of houses. So Attorney Mongerati came in, and I think Mr. Reed mentioned this at our last meeting, gave a presentation to the ZBA, and I think they're taking it quite to heart, and they're trying to figure out how they want to address his recommendations in terms of moving forward with perhaps a different method of bringing those before the ZBA. And they wanted this selectman to be aware of this situation. I know that we saw a copy of that memo, and it may be something that we want to put on a future agenda. I believe there's also a videotape of the training that the ZBA received regarding this issue, and it might be something that that we may want to access if there's a possibility of having the video uploaded some way that we can link to it and watch it. I think they're looking for some guidance and some coherent approach to how to conduct their business in an area that I think in the past has seemed grayer, and there's been some change in case law. I think that they had been operating under a different system, and now they're transitioning. So that's just something to be aware of. And if I can access that video, I'll certainly share that with all of you, so you can hear what advice the town council gave to the ZBA about the situation. And this, you know, this has to do with the issues concerning mansionization, and particularly dramatic changes in the scaling of houses in smaller neighborhoods.
You also talk about liquor licenses.
With the ZBA?
In regard to, you know, the ZBA.
I don't know.
Okay.
I'm not sure that we were, at any rate, at the ZBA meeting the other night, we were just talking about the teardowns issue. Out of Transportation Advisory Committee, we can expect a memo for asking the selectmen to consider some interim improvements at Renzo's. I know that we've asked for there to be an RFP to get some engineering help because of a safety concern there. So that's something that I think that transportation is hoping that will move along more quickly than perhaps the contract process will happen. So I just want to give you a heads up about that. And then I did attend my first meeting of the MBTA Advisory Board, and I just wanted to alert you to the fact that they did take a vote to respond to the governor's proposal concerning the MBTA, approving of his wanting to institute a fiscal management control board, adding community representation to the MassDOT board, which hadn't been there in the past. So towns such as ours, inner and outer communities, will have representation where in the past they didn't. Make MBTA labor contract practices consistent with other public sector unions. But they opposed removing the fare cap and efforts to remove the future funding from the 2013 legislation. The governor was thinking about rescinding the funding essentially for the last 2 years of a five-year future funding scheme. So that input is being translated into a memo and being sent on behalf of the MBTA towns to the Department of Transportation, to the governor. And then finally, I just wanted to alert everyone to the fact that Congressman Moulton is going to be in town on Saturday. He's coming to an event at Old Town Hall I believe it's the Mass Democratic, excuse me, the Town Democratic Committee is holding an event where he's coming, and I plan to attend because I haven't actually managed to make personal contact with him yet, and I think it would be very helpful to put faces and names together so he starts to know who we are, so when we call him the next time.
Do you know what time the event is?
I believe it's either at, I want to say 9 or 9:30 in the morning. It's early. And apropos of that, I think it would be really nice. Also, we heard from Liz Rust a little bit of mention of the Coast Guard RFP process that she was involved with, but just if we can get any sort of update on where we are, if there's anything.
There's no change.
There's no change. Mm-hmm. We haven't had any.
Except that Coast Guard has scheduled a conference call with Jessica and I think next week sometime.
Okay. Well, that's an update.
Yep.
Thank you. Okay. That's it. No funny stories.
I don't have any updates, but I was asked to follow up on where we are with the extra liquor licenses for applying through the state for additional liquor licenses.
State representative has the certified vote of town meeting, and he has begun the process to have the bill introduced at the legislature.
Okay. Same place we were.
No, we're farther ahead.
I know he's gone to.
No, I didn't mean that in any negative way. I just meant there's no, I've given that.
Well, it's a process.
There's
a process. And
he said something to me about it. He said that he had gone to the House legal counsel that helps draft bills for the state reps, and they have it, and they're drafting the final form of the bill.
Great. Okay.
This is to be introduced to the legislature, not final form in the sense of voting to adopt it.
Right.
So it's going to still be a few months, probably.
Right.
Meanwhile, is there one floating around somewhere?
There was one on auction.
We have sent a letter to the Sparta restaurant telling them that they either need to surrender the license to us or we will begin revocation proceedings, because they're not allowed to keep the license after 10 days of not using it. And then, so we expect we'll hear something from them hopefully soon. And then we know that there's Ken's New York Deli is very interested in that license. So they've applied, but
right.
We really shouldn't process their application and
we don't have
hearing because we don't technically
have a license.
And we haven't heard anything in terms of Sparta, the owners coming in to transfer the license to another party?
They had that auction, and the reports back were that the license was not sold at the auction.
I see.
Nobody bid on it. Which isn't surprising if you think that we're going to have 6 more licenses to give. Why would you pay for anything?
Right.
Okay. Well, the only other thing I'll say is I'm scheduled to go to the CONCOM, and I'll try to figure out how to talk about the Trails Committee. So, other than that, motion to adjourn.
I move we adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained. 5-0-0.